Well, it's been a long day. I will try to be energetic and share with you some more insights. Yesterday, I presented some key ideas from my forthcoming book, Convergence Culture, which touches on a lot of the questions we're exploring here. Today, we're going to spend some time drilling down and talking more specifically about the games industry, because that's been one of the places for real innovation in terms of opening up collaboration between consumers and producers in the media industry. So I'm Henry Jenkins again. I'm the director of the Comparative Media Studies Program. I helped head a consortium called Convergence Culture, which has a lot of different media companies involved with it. I'm also one of the leaders of a group called the Education Arcade, which we're going to talk about a little bit in this presentation, which is involved thinking about games and education. And my colleague is David Edery. You want to say something about yourself, David?
So I just joined the Comparative Media Studies program recently, and I focus more or less exclusively on video games and all their various economic and social aspects.
Okay. So I'm going to begin with a story and actually show a video made by one of the fans of a game called Star Wars Galaxies. And this video was shared with me from the USC professor Doug Thomas, who shares my passion for some of these fan communities. And what I'm going to show you is the farewell of a fan artist named Xavier. And Xavier is saying goodbye to the world of Star Wars Galaxies. And as the story goes along, I will explain a little more deeply why he's saying goodbye to this game and what some of the politics behind it is. But for the moment, as you watch it, I want you to think about, first of all, how this gets made. In the world of Star Wars Galaxies, there's an entertainer class of characters who perform for other gamers. And this guy, Xavier, has helped to organize these elaborate Busby Berkeley production numbers in which literally, in some cases, hundreds of gamers are hitting the keyboards in various combinations in relation to each other to stage elaborate musical production numbers. This is each character. What I've got to keep in mind as you see this is each character on the screen is controlled by a separate player somewhere out there, not in the same physical space at all in this choreography. The second thing is to think about the theme of community and investment that comes through this particular work. And those are the two things to keep in mind. I'll say a little more about that after we've seen a bit of the video. Come on. There you go.
Blames the one before, and all of their frustrations come beating on your door. I know that I'm a prisoner to all my father has so dear. I know that I'm a hostage to all his hopes and fears. I just wish I could have told him in the living years. More crumpled bits of paper filled with imperfect thoughts, still to conversations. I'm afraid that's all we've got. You say you just don't see it. He says it's perfect sense. You just can't get agreement in this present tense. We all talk a different language, talking in defense.
Say it loud.
Say it loud.
It's too late.
future. It's the bitterness that lasts. So don't give to the fortunes you sometimes see as fate. You may have a new perspective on a different day. And if you don't give up and don't give in, you may. I just wish I could have told him in the living years. So say, say, say it loud.
Say it clear.
Oh, say it clear. As well as you hear.
It's too late.
So the video, I think, captures a number of things about the fan cultures that have moved up in the gaming space. Most importantly, the notion of collaboration. The word together crops up a number of times in that video. And the together means not just the designer and Xavier, but also is the entire community of gamers around Star Wars Galaxies and the degree to which they felt a sense of participation, of common cause through this game. But also the sense of enormous loss that's experienced. And I want us to trace a little bit the journey Xavier is describing, because I think it illustrates some of the tensions and opportunities that gaming has represented. And the story begins with this guy, Rafe Koster, who's written a very interesting book, A Theory of Game of Fun for Game Design. He was an early modder, early games advocate who's entered into the games industry. And he's someone who's been very outspoken about the importance of engaging your consumer base as part to help create content that extend the opportunities of the particular property involved. And so these are some comments from an interview I did with Rafe for the book. He said, first of all, you can't possibly mandate a fictionally involving universe with thousands of other people. The best you can hope for is a world that is vibrant enough that people act in manners consistent with their fictional tenets. There's no denying it, the fans know Star Wars better than the developers do. They live and breathe it. They know it in an intimate way. On the other hand, with something as large and broad as the Star Wars universe, there's ample scope for divergent opinions about things. These are things that lead to religious wars among fans, and all of a sudden you have to take a side because you're going to establish how it works in the game. And that's the challenge he faced going in. Koster also in the interview said, I absolutely favor empowering people to engage in these acts of creation, because not only does talent bubble up, but also economies of scale apply. If you get a large enough sample size, you will eventually create something good. So here's how he went about, he's inspired in thinking in these ways by this guy, Richard Bartle, another game designer who's done a lot of interesting thinking about the ecologies of multiplayer game worlds. And what Bartle argues is self-expression is another way to promote immersion. By giving players free-form ways to communicate themselves, designers can draw them more deeply into the world. They feel more of a part of it. That's odd. Okay, I lost a slide there. Okay, anyway, Bartle came up with an ecology of gameplay in multiplayer worlds in which he said there are a variety of reasons people play these games. They're explorers, they're socializers, there's, you know, and so forth. And what's interesting about his chart is that he actually shows the complex interactions between those groups. So every group sustains each other group's activity, and there's an ecology principle of a multiplayer game where you want none of those groups to become so far out of hand that they take away from the pleasure of the others. So he saw the design of multiplayer games as a social engineering problem that requires enfranchising your consumer base in order to help generate content and generate experience for each other that becomes mutually satisfactory. So when Coster started applying these principles to Star Wars Galaxies, he does a number of things that really worked. First of all, he respects the expertise and emotional investments fans have already made in the series. And he does this by creating a website at the very beginning of the design process, putting out design documents, floating trial balloons, soliciting feedback. Now, if you imagine if George Lucas had done that for the films instead of keeping everything secret, the Jar Jar Binks would never have happened. You know, the kinds of unpopular elements of the Star Wars films would have not appeared because the feedback he would have gotten would have instantly shut those down and he would have moved in a new direction. But this is very much collaborative authorship. He opens up that channel of communication with fans early in the process. He actively solicits their advice about design decisions, and he follows that advice wherever possible. The idea is to get people invested in the game before it even ships, to be get your consumers so engaged with you, they feel a stake in your own success. As he designs the game, he creates resources which sustain multiple sets of interest in the series, multiple sets of interest in Star Wars, multiple sets of interest within the game. And he designs the gameplay, which allows them various roles that are mutually reinforcing and many, many opportunities to generate content. Now, that may come back to haunt him later. But the goal was to create a space of active participation, active community building. All right, now let's go back to what I talked about yesterday in terms of the entertainment industry today being governed by these two competing logics. What we might call the logic of prohibitionism, which is about tight control of intellectual property, and the logic of collaborationism, which is about empowering your audience to actively collaborate with you to create new kinds of situations and relationships. Then the prohibitionist model is based on a logic of depreciation. And I mean that in the sense that the fear is that if you let us get our hands on your intellectual property, we will destroy its value. We'll trample all over it. We'll tear it apart. It's less valuable than it was before. The collaborationist one is based on a logic of appreciation in two senses. The emotional sense, I appreciated it, I valued it emotionally, my emotional stakes go up because I have the sense of connection to it, I become more loyal to it. But in the second sense of economic appreciation, I increase its value. I make it extend its shelf life, I create new property, I create new experiences, I increase your investment in that property by empowering me to be an active part, an active collaborator and participant in what you've created. The games industry has gone as far as any industry toward the collaborationist model. And so I think anyone who studies this whole open source, open content area really needs to look at experiments like Star Wars Galaxies to see what worked and what didn't work. And so I want to trace through some of the logic of that as we go forward. So David's going to say a little more about user-generated content in the games industry.
Sure. Just briefly, I think it's worth noting the nature of the gamer community in general is it's extremely, extremely passionate, deeply passionate and deeply excited about the things that they play. I think more so than perhaps any other community that I'm familiar with, it's also diverse. I mean, more and more every day, you've got, you know, 10-year-olds and 50-year-olds contributing user-generated content to the same environments and produces some sort of really interesting stuff. So I just wanted to give a few examples of things that has produced, really big things. This is actually the most minor example. Civilization is a famous game franchise. I was speaking with the lead developer of the franchise, and he told me how prior to Civ 4 coming out, the Civ fan community got together and produced a quote-unquote Bible of sort of, you know, instructions and tips and things, you know, requests from the developers and so forth. And apparently this Bible was longer and better organized than the New Testament. So they were pretty floored by that. Even more interestingly, there's a Ultima 5 that's one of the sort of seminal works in the role-playing genre. The fans of the game went so far as to completely remake the game from scratch using modern graphics. I mean, they literally made it from scratch. And of course, they used some sort of engine that was available, but for the most part, it was still a monumental effort, completely spontaneous. And they actually even added some bonus content to the end of it, so, you know, to sort of increase the playtime of the game. That was pretty impressive. What's even more impressive, perhaps, is that the fans of the King's Quest series, which is a very old franchise that's gone through, I think, 8 iterations, were so despondent when they found out that the publisher was canceling it that they decided to make their own sequel. And normally you would expect something like that to be of relatively low quality, but as you can see from the screenshot in the bottom right, the graphics are actually pretty phenomenal. I mean, and this is a completely original work. They're just going to go ahead and make King's Quest IX or whatever it is. And the interesting thing in this case was that the publisher sort of expectedly tried to shut them down. The outcry was so tremendous that, and this is unusual in the industry, the publisher pulled back and said, okay, go ahead, make it. And the only restriction was you can't put King's Quest in the title. Now, I think that was actually a mistake. I think they should have let them put King's Quest in the title. But at least they allowed them to make it. And then I think the last thing, which is just sort of something to note in general, it's informative, is the sort of intense response that the gaming community has to any criticism of games whatsoever. I mean, whether it's somebody's criticizing violence in games or sexuality in games, I mean, you name it, make a comment. If that comment gets attention, it is going to be attacked by tens of thousands of people. I mean, and I mention that not as a critique, but simply to note yet again that, I mean, this is a community that really cares about the medium. And if you can, sort of capture that passion, there's a lot you can do with it.
All right, so we're at one end of the spectrum are literally hackers. One of our grad students, Brett Camper, is in a study of the Game Boy Advance modding community. And this is a place where even access to the dev kit is strictly prohibited. So you've got to break into the system in order to begin programming and developing games. And he located hundreds of games people had made for that game system, generating their own content. So just the existence of the game, that code, is already to be in violation of all kinds of laws and so forth. But it's very sophisticated work, very interesting work system, very interesting experiments in game design. And again, that becomes a training ground for future programmers entering the industry, as we talked about with Sandy yesterday. This stuff, as David will tell us, extends the life of games in many cases.
Right. So, I mean, this is just one of the many benefits of permitting this kind of collaboration with your users. So there's a well-known game called Battlefield 1942. This was a while ago, this was back in 405, but when I checked FilePlanet.com for user-generated maps for the game, I found over 500. I mean, you know, probably the game came out with, 10, 20, something like that. I'm not sure what the exact number was. And of course, I mean, you can imagine, if you enjoy the game, you are eventually going to get bored of those normal maps, but you could never possibly get bored of 500, even if, you know, only a tenth of those are pretty good. That's still rather impressive. World of Warcraft, which many of you have probably heard about, it's the most most popular massive multiplayer role-playing game out right now by leaps and bounds. That game's interesting because it enables you to generate sort of modifications that change the interface of the game. It's a very simple thing. I mean, it's not a huge modification by any stretch of the imagination, but it increases player satisfaction tremendously. I mean, if you're one of those people, for some reason, you're deeply dissatisfied with the interface, it's detracting from your enjoyment of the game, well, you know, you just slap this add-on, customize it a little bit, and now the game looks more like the way you want it to. It's easier to use in whatever way you see fit. So now, you know, this thing that may have been a source of irritation that would eventually have forced you to quit the game no longer exists. And these add-ons are tremendously popular. I mean, they're shared on the internet. There are, you know, millions of people using certain ones. And then lastly, and this is just leaps, you know, this is a class all by itself, is, you know, this game called Neverwinter Nights that was released with a toolkit that basically enabled users to make any part of the, you know, make their own, basically their own role-playing games. I mean, it was the same engine that the developers used to make the Neverwinter Nights campaign itself. And, I mean, at that point, it was literally like de-emphasizing the first-party content. I mean, the developers couldn't have cared less if people just bought the toolkit, used it to make their own games and play those, and never even played Neverwinter Nights as it was, you know, initially intended to be played, that would have been fine. And true enough, lots and lots of content was created.
So here's a quote from Ray Mazaika. I never can pronounce his name. Anyway, he was speaking at one of Marsha's conferences at USC. He said, if only 1% of a million user base makes content, then you have a lot of module designers, and that's enough to make a game self-sustaining for a long time. So we've discovered this in terms of the work we've been doing with educational games. This is a screenshot from a game called Revolution we're working on. In a minute, I'll show you a preview of that game. This is a game we built entirely by taking the fantasy game Neverwinter Nights, rebuilding it from the ground up to recreate colonial Williamsburg on the eve of the American Revolution. We did it in less than a year, working with a handful of undergraduate programmers and a graduate student supervisor. This potential of this is to enable the rapid production of games for education that have the quality and feel of an existing commercial game. There are downsides of this as well, I'll say in a minute, but let me pull this up big enough to see. And this is an example of what we've done. Neverwinter Nights has been modded by a number of other researchers around the country. Marcia was showing her Russian constructivist game and said that that was based, Quake 2, you said?
Half-Life 2.
So a number of different game engines are being used in this way, and it really speeds up development time. Now, the downside of that is that as these games get rolled into the classroom, you have to have Neverwinter Nights in order to use them in the school. And what we found that because Neverwinter Nights is a sword and sorcery game, And the opening credits include their logo, which has iconography in it. We've had many schools terrified of bringing that into the classroom because of anxieties about conservative Christians and so forth. So that's proving to be more of an issue than we might have imagined building the back of Neverwinter Nights. But the potential of doing something quickly, cheaply, with amateur talent to do something that transforms education is there as a result of that.
So there's a lot of different ways for the game industry to profit from user-generated content, and there's the direct approach, which I'm just curious, how many people here have heard of Second Life? Pretty much everybody.
Nothing.
Okay, so almost all of you have heard about it. Just a few facts, and that would be interesting. So for those of you who don't know, it's driven entirely by user-generated content. I mean, the way that the CEO of the company that of Linen Lab puts it, he's like, we sell virtual dirt. That's how he puts it. I mean, there is almost no other base content. Users are given a lot of very powerful tools that enable them to do interesting things in games. I mean, they can put up houses, they can build cars that can actually be driven around. I mean, it's fairly complex. It's entirely free to play. The only thing you pay is if you want to buy a virtual land, and then you pay some small fee for the virtual land, and you pay what's effectively a monthly land tax. And I was astonished to find out that Second Life, which isn't even really all that popular yet, is already making apparently about $400,000 a month off of the land tax alone. That doesn't include a bunch of other revenue from the initial sale, from a cut of the exchange that they take from when someone converts virtual dollars to real dollars, they take a cut. So I mean, they're making good money. And here's what I find really interesting is that there's already a number of users I hear anywhere between 100 to 200 that are making their full-time incomes, like significant full-time incomes, off of what they do in the game. So first of all, there's about $50 million in annual in-game transactions as of very recently. Two people who I wanted to profile, one of them, I don't know what their real names are in the game, one of them is Cassie Nafis. She's a virtual clothing designer, and other players pay her about $60,000 a year for the virtual outfits she designs. Anchi Chung is much more interesting. Anchi Chung is a virtual real estate developer, and she's making approximately $175,000 a year. She buys virtual land, she develops it, makes it look really nice, puts up pretty buildings, I don't know, whatever, and then sells it for a profit. She owns approximately 5% of the entire virtual world, apparently. And yeah, I mean, and those are just two people. There's many more who are making full-time incomes, and many, many more who are making part-time incomes and or just doing it for fun and enjoying themselves. And actually, it's not on this slide because it just happened in the last day or so, but recently a real-world company started selling real-world products for virtual dollars, because these virtual dollars are effectively real dollars. I mean, there's an exchange rate and everything. So you can get like a video card for your computer for 20,000 virtual bucks in the game. It's interesting.
So here are just some images of some of the activities going on within Second Life, including a lot of collaboration between real-world companies. Wells Fargo owned an island in Second Life, for example. So key player in all of this is Will Wright, who sort of helps run Maxis, which has created The Sims, probably the largest franchise, the most successful game franchise of all time. And he says about it, we're probably responsible for the first million or so units sold, but it was the community which brought it to the next level. Or another interview, he said to me, when I interviewed him, he said, all of these different games are competing for communities, which in the long run are what will drive our sales. Whichever game attracts the best community will enjoy the most success. What you can do to make the game more successful is not to make the game better, but to make the community better. And so again, this notion of collaboration, of participation is sort of foundational to it. The image on the screen there was of the Mall of the Sims, which is this vast retail space on the web where people go to buy and trade goods that they created for use inside the world of The Sims. And Will Wright has allowed many of these kind of people to sell their materials to each other using his IP, but generating some modest profit off of it because he realized the bandwidth that was costing these people cost them something, and so they wanted to sustain the activity. It was more profitable for him to allow them to make some modest profit off of his IP than it was to shut them down, because the loss of publicity and the loss of community building they did would be a greater risk. They do everything. This is a site for The Sims which does tapestries for decoration. So some beautifully done stuff. Product placements are being generated. This is something the advertising industry would be rather interested in. Many, these are products that are designed to be placed in the world of The Sims by players. This is someone who did the entire catalog of IKEA furniture that could be placed inside the world of The Sims. And this is a global phenomenon. This is early in the days of The Sims. The list of countries involved would be much, much larger today, but just the people all over the world are involved with it. It's a storytelling medium as well. People take snapshots of gameplay. They write narratives around it, but in fact, it starts to reverse itself, and more people are playing the game simply to generate the images they need in order to tell certain stories. So people have done the Kennedy assassination. There's someone who's done a complete version of one of the Harry Potter novels, with shot by shot. All of the incidents in the book were staged in The Sims. This is a filmmaker, from a high school age filmmaker we met doing some more research for media literacy, and he's won national prizes as a high school filmmaker using The Sims. He says it's like directing trained animals, because since you don't directly control the Sim, you sort of suggest things for it to do. Your Sim can start urinating on the floor in the middle of a shot and spoil a scene, and you really have to just create an interesting context and hope for the best stuff to come out of it. But it's a very interesting form of filmmaking.
So, and then along the lines of profiting indirectly from user-generated content, which game companies also do, and in fact do much more often, I'm just going to stick with the most famous example, which is a game called Counter-Strike. Counter-Strike is a modification, user-made modification, of a very famous game called Half-Life. The reason the game Half-Life is famous is probably more to do with Counter-Strike than with anything else. It was developed entirely by the users, at least initially. Later, the users were all hired by the company. It's the most popular online first-person shooter in history, much more popular than anything else, including the Half-Life upon which it was based. In 2002, back when it first came out, I believe, it exceeded its second-place rival in terms of popularity by about a factor of three. I mean, really, really popular. According to the developer themselves, they estimate that it probably increased the period of time over which it grew in revenues by, again, also by a factor of three. Usually, a popular AAA title will, keep making money at a steady clip for about a year, and then it trails off pretty steeply. And this game just kept going up and up and up for 3 years because of Counter-Strike. And actually, what's even more interesting is that the user-generated content created for Counter-Strike, there's more of it than there is for Half-Life. it spawned its whole sub-generation of UGC, which is great.
So Machinima is another variant of this. This is the games were shipping with engines which were designed to allow players to record their gameplay. People immediately began using that as a form of low-cost, real-time computer-generating animation. So this is a version of the Matrix that was staged using, I think, one of the Quake engines. This is a list early on in Machinima of just some of the films that are out there, and you can see the range of genres, comedy, action, horror, science fiction, drama, so forth, used in a wide variety of engines. Joel talked yesterday about Red versus Blue as the most successful example of Machinima-generated content. Well, we're seeing this spill over into the corporate sector, so Volvo has created an advertising campaign which makes extensive use of Machinima-generated content. And MTV2 has created an entire series, music mods, or video mods, rather, that is, in fact, based totally on music videos for rock stars created using game engine-style animation. So we're seeing it feed back in this innovation loop to shape the media industry directly. To build on that, in turn, Peter Molyneux, the creator of a game called The Movies, which just was released this fall, he wanted to, it's first of all a simulation of a movie studio, Hollywood, in the sort of golden era, but it also was designed to make it very easy for kids, in particular, to generate their own movies and share them via the internet. Now, the first use of it, one of the first highly publicized uses of it, was by students in France who wanted to respond to the uprisings there and did a film that that sort of depicts the struggle of democracy that's taking place in France, using some pretty powerful images they were generating in the games. That got a lot of national attention on the blogging circuit. And Peter Molyneux responded, and he said, "We wanted to make the game that allows anyone to easily express themselves by making a short film and then posting them online to share it with the world." Alex's film, which is absolutely terrific, really demonstrates the potential power and impact these films can have. Now, any of the energies directed using these games for protest can also be directed against the company. Counter-Strike, a protest about violence in games that was used using the Velvet Strike, rather, used Counter-Strike. This is a sit-in that took place in the World of Warcraft. And this is another protest against company policies that took place in Second Life itself. So we're starting to see people take the master's tools and literally use them to modify and dismantle the master's house in a variety of ways. So this becomes a kind of political speech through games that becomes rather significant. A second issue that's cropping up as we think about user-generated content, though, is while Maxis may be totally comfortable with us taking The Sims and generating new property, its lawyers are struggling with the question of what happens when, as these people did, you make a skin for The Sims based on X-Men, owned by Marvel, or Gilligan's Island in this case. This is Gillisim's Island, but Harry Potter. And so far, Maxis's position is they're not controlling that. If people want to create that stuff, put it in the game, they're not liable, they're not responsible. And so far, no one, as far as we know, other media corporation has gone after Maxis. But there was a court case brewing over this very question. It involves this game, City of Heroes, which is a superhero multiplayer game, which has an extraordinary interface where you can design a character making about 20 different choices, the vocabulary of which are the basic building blocks of the superhero genre as it unfolded over time. And every character is totally different, but fits coherently within the world. But that ran afoul of Marvel. And Marvel asserted in a legal suit that this was nothing more than a tool for piracy, that in a sense you could use it to manufacture the Incredible Hulk. And that was their example, which points to the hypocrisy of the current situation. Because if you know something about comic book history, you know that in the early 1960s, Martin Goodwin, who was the head of Timely Comics, wrote to Jack Kirby a very famous memo in which he said, "We want to design a character that is a super Frankenstein figure with the personality of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde." Now, you might imagine that Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde and Mary Shelley's Frankenstein were in the public domain, but the memo goes on to say, "We're doing it because Aurora's model released the previous year of the Universal Frankenstein figure. Was so successful, they wanted to capitalize on that with their own character, and so they created the Incredible Hulk." And we might imagine that's buried somewhere in the history, except as this image here suggests, and many others, the comic has continually cited reference back to Frankenstein and back to the Universal monsters. So we live in a world where Marvel feels totally right to take Universal's property and exploit it, but is frightened when City of Heroes allows players to do the same thing. But the world gets even more interesting than that because, of course, if you go to the Marvel site, you will start to see images like these of people dressing up in Halloween, like the Hulk, wearing these things in public. And this has never been prosecuted as public performance. which is the clause they've been intending to use to go after City of Heroes. It's a widespread practice over an extended period of time that's been endorsed by the comic book industry quite openly. So what's the difference between this act, and suppose I wore that to shopping mall, a stadium, an amusement park, which might be having costume competition, I surely would be seen by many, many more people than is ever going to see that character within a virtual space of the game. So the legal implications of trying to sort out in which it, whether this is a violation of copyright because it's publishing or whether it's a simply an extension of Halloween costuming with now a virtual avatar instead of a costume seems to me would have been a rich case. Unfortunately, that suit, which a number of scholars, myself included, filed an amicus brief on, but the two companies settled out of court, and so we won't ever see legal precedent that might allow us to make sense of that phenomenon. So all that brings us back to Star Wars Galaxy and Xavier, who I started this story with. And David, you want to speak to
sure,
this line?
So, and I don't pretend to know exactly what went wrong with Star Wars Galaxies. It's a complicated issue, but this was a review that came out shortly after the game was released, and I guess really the first sentence kind of says it all. A lot of people would wander around in the world and, you know, I mean, maybe they'd be on the desert planet, for example, and, I mean, it was really a desert planet. You know, some cactus, some, you know, some weeds, and not much else out there, and a lot of people complained, this isn't really how I imagine Star Wars. I imagine me running around, you know, fighting with a lightsaber and whatnot. And so there's a question of why didn't these users do more to entertain themselves? Since that's we seem to be arguing throughout this entire presentation that that's what they do if you give them the ability to. And I guess that's kind of my point. I think that in the case of this particular game, maybe they weren't really given the ability to entertain themselves to the full extent necessary. They certainly weren't enabled to like build structures in game. They certainly weren't enabled to fundamentally modify their character if they were so capable with, you know, with graphics technologies and scripting and so forth. So I think to the extent that, I mean, if you're going to make an argument as Rafe did that that you're dedicated to that kind of content, you really actually have to be dedicated to that kind of content, regardless of the risks that entails. There are other ways around it. I mean, I think the game would have been successful without user-generated content if it simply had a lot of fun developer-made content. There are enough fans of Star Wars out there that it was probably a no-brainer. But in this case, it was kind of the worst of both worlds. Not enough developer-made content and no users rushing in to fill the gap. And so a game which sort of, by all expectations, should have been a huge success was a failure.
And so I think we're going to be studying Star Wars Galaxies for some time to try to understand what works and what doesn't work in user-generated content. In some ways, it got caught between Second Life, which was all user-generated content, and World of Warcraft, which had very well-developed entertainment content by the designer. It was somewhere in the middle, and since those two things hit at about the same time, it sort of those fractions split off. But what tended to happen as well was there's many, many projects. There's a displacement of the manager of the project, and Rafe got pushed aside by a new manager who had a very different consumer relations policy. And what we've seen shortly before Christmas, the New York Times ran an article about the degree to which Star Wars Galaxies was being retooled. And the spokesman for the team retooling the game offered this comment, which is full of things that just left me furious. But she says, "We really just needed to make the game a lot more accessible to a much broader player base. There was lots of reading, much too much in the game. There was a lot of wandering around learning about different abilities. We really needed to give people the experience of being Han Solo or Luke Skywalker rather than being Uncle Owen, the moisture farmer. We wanted more instant gratification. Kill, get treasure, repeat. We need to give people more of an opportunity to be part of what they've seen in the movies rather than something they had created themselves." And so what you're seeing is a management and real backlash against this thing. Now, the retooling was already generating controversy among the games community. But this statement just totally inflamed the community. And so Xavier's video was a response in part to this mass exodus that was taking place of the most committed fans who had most invested in this game leaving in fury over the shift in policy and the move from building trust with the fan community is set up expectations that are now being dashed by this sort of contempt for the fan community, which many people read in this particular comment. So how was a galaxy lost? Well, first of all, I think she's confusing accessibility with simplicity. And what we're seeing again and again is the argument of Stephen Johnson's book, How Everything Bad is Good for You, is that many forms of popular culture today are successful precisely because they're complex. that to simplify it and dumbing it down is probably the wrong direction to go with if what you're trying to do is appeal to the contemporary consumer. Secondly, don't underestimate the intelligence of your consumers, and I might add to that, if you're going to underestimate the intelligence of your consumers, don't tell the New York Times about it. Right? Because and telling the New York Times that she thought her consumers were stupid and didn't read, among other things, that what then happened was they read the New York Times, it circulated via the internet, it rallied anger against her and against her policies for that particular game. Don't assume that fans want the same experience from every installment of the same franchise. Right? This is another message to take away from her comments, was to say, well, the movies have Han Solo, so let's put Han Solo in the game. And it's pretty clear at this point that fans want new experiences with each installment, not a repetition. And in fact, there had been a lot of discussion on the original boards about how a world where everyone's Han Solo is totally boring, right? You can't have a world where everyone gets to be the same protagonist. So what Coster had tried to do was make a number of different roles in the game interesting, build those up. None of them happen to be moisture farmers, but build those things up in such a way, including the entertainer class. And as they came in, they began to strip those roles down to try to emphasize the roles that were known from the film. Don't underestimate the diversity of fan cultures. People want lots of different things from this. That was the whole ecological model that Coster was relying on. Don't underestimate the value of fan creative contributions to the success of media franchises. The contempt in that statement for fan-generated content flies in the face of everything we've said in this presentation. And maybe most powerfully, don't sacrifice your existing fan base in search of a totally different market. It would have been one thing to create new opportunities of play within the game that sustain the activities of the existing fans, quite another to push them aside, to destroy that loyalty, to sort of destroy their experience in order to make way for a bird in the bush as opposed to what you had in your hand. So rather than, even if they were anxious about the success of the game, they would have been much wiser to begin to work with the fan community again to broaden outward and to do some recruiting in ways that enhance the experience rather than taking it away. So that's Xavier's story and why that opening video has the poignancy it does, is it's about the end of one of the best experiments so far in how to create user-generated content, and one that I think we are going to study for some time to come to understand the potentials of open content economically, culturally, socially, politically. Thank you.
Questions? Comments?
I was just wondering if you could comment upon the ability to perform research within the actual MorPeg. I know Second Life has restrictions on what kind of research you can do, but what the potentialities are in that?
Well, Second Life does have some restrictions on research, but it's also been very open to research communities and research uses. It's a game that's being used in very interesting ways. One of the things that people are using Second Life with is autistic kids. People are doing sessions with autistic kids to get them to learn how to read signs. They're simplifying the social interaction down to game personas allows them to really focus on certain signs and refine skills and then carry those back to the real world. So there's a lot of research in Second Life. There are some anxieties about, people don't want to go there and just become one big laboratory that we all circle around and study. And so there have been some protection of those communities. The best research on this stuff gets done in collaboration with fan communities. You don't just layer over, peer down and survey people. You work with these fan bases. So for the Star Wars stuff, I'm drawing heavily on Doug Thomas, who has done some of the best work on Star Wars Galaxies, and on Kurt Squire and Constance Steinkuhler, who are also really good researchers who've looked on this community very closely over an extended period of time. And there's some really good work, but it's done by people who are part of the community to begin with, not people who went there just to experiment or to study.
I'd like to just add briefly, I've been really impressed with how open the industry has been to sort of research in general. I'm currently brokering a relationship between economics PhDs at MIT and Harvard and two of the major MMO makers, and they're thrilled to be working with them. I mean, they're opening up the back end and going to let them do economic studies, and it's great. Yeah.
Could you talk a little more about the transition of those principles about users and fans in your experience with Colonial Williamsburg and or other museums?
Yeah, I mean, what we took from this for that project, first off, was the modding technique as a way of getting up to speed really quickly. And working with Williamsburg, we were able to go to Williamsburg, take digital photographs, collaborate with them on identifying, create a pretty realistic version of the village, the Williamsburg village as it existed. In some ways, it doesn't look like the one now, because they put trees in the park to protect tourists from the sun. They weren't there originally, and there are a number of changes that we worked with to make sure we're there. But as we apply that in the classroom, the other thing we're doing is we're using machinima, that is the ability to generate gameplay recordings of gameplay, to help kids articulate and express what they learned in the game. So the kids make diaries in character, both video diaries and written diaries, to express what happened to their character in the gameplay. And that's become very useful for getting them to articulate what they learned. You discover that performing those characters allows them to mobilize what they know from history, what they know from introspection, what they know from the game in very powerful ways. And it helps us to understand the learning that's taking place and what would constitute teachable moments. So, for example, you saw that massacre at the end where the Redcoats were opening fire. And we had one student who was playing a loyalist character who describes to us the anger she felt because she showed up to see this protest and she was on their side. And they opened fire and she got killed. You know, and the notion that political violence had innocent bystanders was an eye-opener for this kid. She was expecting them to observe sides. And when she was killed, it sort of made her think about what a revolution was about in very powerful ways, because she was inside that world, because she was playing that role. Now, if we can presumably, if academics work together with these mods, then create game spaces that people can add on to themselves. And you can imagine our mod of Williamsburg then being turned into Sturbridge Village or some other living history museum experiments. That it's possible to extend outward and create some sort of vast historical museum on the web that was based on the same principles of Second Life. I think we're just beginning to explore the implications of this for the development of educational content.
The potential for documentary filmmaking to utilize some of the assets that are created in nonfiction content and deploy it in the gaming community to build kind of a user base or a fan base or a market, pretty extraordinary. We just shot a short film in historic Deerfield. And if, you know, I've seen your presentation before then, we could have taken some of those images, taken some of those clips, and made them available to a gaming community.
Yeah, and I think the history has been one of the most powerful spaces for games. We mentioned Civilization earlier. I didn't talk about work Kurt Squire has been doing on Apollinaire University, which is a whole digital university with all kinds of courses taught by fans of the game Civilization on the historical background of the game, on strategy, on tactics, and it's a totally open-source university with some support from the company that makes Civilization. They help publicize it. They help to encourage people to use the game, to study history, and to use history to develop new techniques to play the game better.
I think that, you know, the importance of the fan community is terrific and very important, and the user-generated games, I think it's really important. I'm wondering, when you're in an educational situation where you're teaching people, you have a game program, because we have this issue at USC, both in the program that's run by Scott Fisher and funded by Electronic Arts, so there's also a collaborative, you know, with the corporation. It seems to me there's always that issue about whether what you're doing is feeding people into the industry or also encouraging people to come up with other models. You know, that, and partly what you're saying about, well, it's a fast way doing the mods, I totally agree, and that's what we've chosen as well. But one of the things we're finding is that there are a lot of students that are coming, you know, and particularly foreign students. And this is really partly because of having, you know, really very strong computer science skills that are coming up with really alternative models that are very exciting. I mean, in terms of really expanding what's possible in the game world. And another alternative is Bill Viola has come, and you know he's collaborating with some of the big game people on a game on a Zen quest, you know, using his imagery. So I sort of wonder how you think about this balance, whereas, you know, what I'm totally for this kind of participation with the game community, the fan community, but I think that one needs the broader, you know, vision, you know.
Yeah, I wouldn't argue with it at all. I mean, my own philosophy is let a thousand flowers bloom, right? We want as many different models of games out there. to some degree, modding is resulting in people mastering the basic building blocks of games as they currently exist. To some degree, they're already breaking the tools. It fascinates me that this film about French democracy was one of the first to really take off around the movies. No one would have expected that as a subject matter that people would use that games to express itself with. There is a lot of amazing avant-garde work done in machinima cinema, in the machinima movement. So I think that it's not an either or even. It's not, the amateur and the avant-garde, the lines between them are as blurry as the lines between the amateur and the commercial. I think what we want as universities is to be able to use tools in a variety of ways to both explore what those tools can use that the industry would never create. And I don't think the industry is going to create a game about Colonial Williamsburg anytime soon either. I just built on the base. Now, one of the criticisms the game's received from some educators is because we built on the existing game, the colonial fathers are pretty damn buff, and the founding mothers have large breasts. And that's because we're building on the existing frames of those characters. And so there are ideological implications of building over, layering over that existing game, that it makes certain things hard to break out of, and some things harder to change than other things. And that's definitely something that I think we really want to think about once we've gone down that road for a while.
We are going to hear next from David Weinberger, the man who brought us the Cluetrain Manifesto, and then we're going to move into the concluding two panels on business interests and open content and the very end. Please thank our panel.
Thanks. So I may end up speaking a little quickly because I know everybody wants a break so you can talk with each other. And I do want to talk, I find I'm on a related theme. The dialectic keeps coming up, and I think that's because we are at a dialectical moment, and we're uncertain what's going to happen. I mean, Yochai Benkler and Henry Jenkins both talked about it. They're talking about it in somewhat different terms. I'm going to talk about it in a third set of terms, but it is the question, I think. What is going to happen? We are in a struggle between forces that are messy but also somewhat identifiable. You can simplify them to, as long as you understand you're simplifying them, you can simplify them to a couple of broad forces, and they are at as close to metaphorical war as industries and non-warring governments get. So I want to talk, I think of this as a tragic irony that we're facing, and I want to talk about two aspects, the two things in contention. First is the rise of the miscellaneous, which is usually the category that represents the failure of your categorization system. Too much stuff gets shoved into the miscellaneous bin, then your categorization failed. And the second is the rise of digital, and especially content totalitarianism, which it scares the daylights out of me. So it turns out that for the past couple of millennia, we've been organizing our ideas and our knowledge and our works in the same way that we organize our laundry. And there's a good reason for that. It's because we've externalized our knowledge. We've learned how to write things down, and that externalizes knowledge, and then it becomes a thing, and we have to organize it. So we organize it in thing-like ways. So I think it's useful to think, this is oversimplification, but I'm okay with that, to think about this, think about three orders of order. And in the first one, you organize the things themselves, the books on the shelf. In the second, you physically separate the metadata from the objects, and you organize it, so you build a card catalog. Card catalogs and other types of second-order organization are fantastic. They're a cornerstone of civilization. But there are limits. So we can organize in your library card catalog. We can do author, subject, and title. We have three basic ways of organizing, and we can add some more maybe, but we can't add a whole lot more. You can't also put in organized by publisher, by year of publication, by the gender of the authors, by all the words in the book's index, or your card catalog will be bigger than the library. So there are limitations to what we can do in a second-order organization. But now we're in a third order, where everything is digital. The information is digital, and the metadata is digital. Everything is digital. And digital, you don't have size issues, and you can do all sorts of things. So here's what you do, okay? Here's what I think is happening, and I see this in various places. Instead of you organizing your stuff for your users, you instead build a big pile of miscellaneous stuff.
And the stuff is really well marked with metadata so that people can find what they need. And you allow your users to add metadata. The clearest example of that is the tagging movement that's growing up. You allow people to tag or to annotate. So instead of you supplying a top-down taxonomy, which maybe and very likely is highly useful, instead of instead of that being the only way through this pile, you do that, but you also enable users to sort and organize on the fly. So the strategy becomes completely different. The strategy as an information supplier becomes to be as inclusive as possible, to include as much stuff in this miscellaneous pile as you can, to include as much metadata as you possibly can. Because you can't anticipate what people are going to be looking for, how they're going to want to sort it and order it. And so the editorial function, this has an effect on what constitutes authority, because the editorial function, the organization of information, is a place where authority comes in. You cannot go into Macy's or Filene's, soon to be the same thing, I believe. You cannot go in there and start pulling off the racks everything that is your size. Because most of Filene's is noise. Most of it is stuff that doesn't fit you or you don't care about. But if you try to fix that problem in the second order by pulling off all of the clothing that is only yours to make a rack of that, you'll get arrested immediately. You'll be thrown out. You're not allowed to do that because in the second order, the people who own the information own the organization of that information. But in the third order, that does not have to be the case. And users will increasingly resent the fact if you don't let them organize your information the way they want to. And the result is that we have all sorts of resources, digital resources, every type of content you can imagine that's being freed of its own strictures, including, obviously, the strictures of station and time, programming schedules. Why should we be? That's a limitation of the second order, that we have to wait until you the broadcaster, are able to play the piece for us. That's why should we have to do that? We don't do that on the web. We look things up. So we're able to break all sorts of resources out of their old ways of being categorized and to make them available in a huge miscellaneous pile so users can sort and order and get their stuff as they need it. The strategy is inclusion, the value of filtering on the way in or providing, of being the sole supplier of the organization of the information on the way out. For example, a newspaper that decides what goes on the front page. A newspaper has to decide that in the print world. In the electronic world, it does not have to be the only one who figures out what goes on the front page. So the strategy. So instead of providing value by filtering on the way in and excluding information that you think isn't of value to us, instead of providing the sole way of organizing it and building the front page for your users, now users can do it. And that is a threat to authority. The argument over when citizen journalism is going to happen is an interesting argument. It's important. But the fact is that citizen editing has already happened. We're already reading, many of us on the web, we're reading the newspapers and the news sources through weblogs, through recommendations in email and on sites that actively solicit recommendations. We're not reading the front page that's composed for us because that always contains, like Filene's, it contains a lot of stuff we don't care about. Just the way it is. It has to be that way. So instead, we have already taken over the editorial function. And given the extent to which newspapers and magazines view the editorial function as the crown of their value, this is a rather startling development, and it's already done. Done deal, right? We're already doing that. So I understand this makes some industries nervous, and that's as it should be. It's a challenge to authorities, also a challenge to revenue models. The BBC is doing this, is able to do this, because as you've just heard, bad head for figures. So what was $85 a person as opposed to the $1.27 for public broadcasting in the U.S.? I mean, they're a well-funded organization through a license, through a tax. So BBC is doing this because they're able to. They don't have the revenue problem that most other broadcasters have. Nevertheless, whether companies do this or not, whether broadcasters do this or not, we'll do it for ourselves. We're already doing it with TiVo or for the Linux anointed with MythTV. So this is happening. So here we have this incredible opportunity as a culture to take all of the content, to sort it, to find it, to organize it, to pull it together in new ways, to get stuff that's customized to our interests, to build communities around it, as you've just been hearing about. It's an unbelievable opportunity. The walls of the libraries are fantastic, but they have walls because they have to have walls because they're confined in space. Those walls are down. What more could a librarian want? What more could somebody who cares about culture want? And we're there. We're there through the growth of the miscellaneous. So that's part one. Part two is this other thing that's going on, which is we're rapidly building ourselves a police state for content. Totalitarianism in the political realm is complete control over your political and some degree social relationships and activities. Totalitarianism in the content realm is complete control over content. And we are hearing very serious arguments, and not just arguments, but policies, regulations, procedures, and economic models, all designed to create a totalitarian state, a police state for content. By the way, it's loaded language. You know where I stand. So I'm not pretending to be fair here. This is happening through a series of steps, each one of which may be great, and I understand that the people who support them are supporting them in many cases for the best of reasons. Occasionally not for the best, but you put these together and you have something really scary. So you put together what I consider to be the insanity around copyright, hysteria around copyright, that results in 70 years after the person's dead. You put together the next thing that's happening is well-meaning, well-intentioned arguments and policies for digital ID, and because I'm being fast, I'm going to lump together into that the accountability movement and the people who would like to get rid of anonymity. Third element here that I see is digital restrictions management, DRM. Fourth is the notion that carriers of content should have some control over that content, a very scary idea. It's happening very soon, the restructuring of the software, the operating system, and the hardware itself to enable a police state for content. This stuff is well on the way. It's going to take a lot to derail it at this point. So why does this matter? Because two big consequences of this, if this type of totalitarianism succeeds, as it looks like it will. First is it's hugely chilling on free speech. So, for example, you can tell me all you want about the advantages of digital ID, which are legion. There are many real, real advantages to digital ID, and how it doesn't impede free speech because there'll be multiple authorities for granting, for authenticating who you are. And it'll be an open marketplace, a free market for authenticating bodies, which is a wonderful idea, except in China, where this will immediately be a tool of repression. So you have just closed the internet for political dissidents. It's not a good idea. That is literal police state, a police state for content. And the discussions I've heard about digital ID seem to be unaware of any place outside of the US and Europe. So a chilling effect on free speech, less so in the US, more so in countries that most need free speech, where the internet could be a vehicle of freedom, a vehicle of hope. Second little effect that it has is that it chills innovation. If I have to build software and hardware that meet some set of regulations that are there in order to make sure that users don't misuse the content and build the incredible Hulk in City of Superheroes, then why, if I'm open to lawsuit, if I'm open to investigation by the FBI because I'm not supporting Kalia, that chills innovation. You can't be in a garage anymore because you're afraid you're going to get sued and your parents are going to get sued. So these are, from my point of view, these are bad things, if I haven't made that clear. So I want to make a plea for leeway. The danger is that we see that we can do with bits what we have not been able to do in the real world, which is namely to track and manage every last one of them throughout their entire lifetimes. We can see everything that somebody's doing with it. And so we get to enforce the letter of the law, the letter of the contract or the user agreement. Why is this a bad thing? Well, okay, so you're a landlord, and you rent out your house, your apartment to somebody, and there's a no painting without my permission clause, very common. So the tenant's cat scratches the door up. The tenant goes out, gets some paint, and paints the door and fixes it. Same color, just touches it up. The tenant has violated that contract, violated that lease. And if this was being run by software, that tenant would be evicted because software is stupid. And it always will be stupid about the things that matter most, namely human judgment. So here we are building into software a set of critical decisions that only humans should be making about what constitutes fair use, when I'm abusing your material, abusing your content. We can't live without leeway. Leeway comes before everything else. Leeway comes before the law, because otherwise the law is a tyrant. And when you bake your regulations into software, when you bake them into hardware, and you back them up with the government, you've just become a tyrant. You are now living under in a tyranny, a content tyranny. So one of the ways of approaching this is to look at the question of fairness. Because behind all of this, one of the most powerful arguments behind, on the side of control, is the fairness argument, which says, you know, you have artists, and they're doing their work, and they're building things of value, so they should be paid according to the value that they created. I mean, that's fair. Well, only sort of. It's fair by a particular definition of fairness, which says that fairness consists of an equal exchange of value. So that if I buy shoes from you, and I'm paying leather prices, and you give me leather shoes, that's great. But if I'm paying leather prices, and you sneakily substitute plastic shoes, unequal exchange of value, unfair. So that's the value, that's the definition of fairness that's being used here. And it's appropriate for many things. It's appropriate for buying shoes. It is inappropriate for creative works. For example, libraries let people reread works without paying the author a penny. That's unfair by this definition. You reread a book, you buy a book, equal exchange of value, then you reread it, you've just cheated the author. Why, that's unfair. We can't have that. You pay for the cable TV and you just get your programs in and you're watching them, and the next night the show's coming on and you invite five people over to watch the show with you. You've gotten five times the value, but you haven't paid the cable company a single penny more. Why, that's unfair. Well, of course it's not unfair. Or perhaps it really is unfair. You know, if you could track all that, we don't have to pay for rereading a book or inviting friends in to watch TV because they don't know about it. Nobody knows. The cable company doesn't know. And if they were able to know somehow, then maybe they would make the fairness argument. They'd say, well, whoa, back off. You owe us five times your monthly rate because you had friends in to watch. So we've had this leeway because there's been no choice about it. But in the digital world, we can know. We can know if you download a book, we can know every time you turn the page. If you turn a page back, we charge you another penny. You read it a second time, we either don't let you or we charge you more. We can know all that. So fairness says we ought to be charging for it. But that so fundamentally misunderstands the nature of content, of creative works. Because they're not shoes. We don't consume them. We're not consumers of content. Content changes us. This is why this matters. This is why it's always mattered to culture. Content changes us. We are a different person because we heard that song that touched us or we read that book. Content makes us. And in order to make us, we have to let it shape us. And once it's shaped us, we have to re-express it. And I'm not talking about mashups. Long may they wave. That's not what I have in mind. I mean the fact that once I have read a book or heard a song, it has changed me, and because it has changed me, I will re-express it. And that's exactly what we want. Otherwise, all we have are jingles rattling around in our head. That's the content that we can reuse. That's not what we want. We want works to change us. And the totalitarian regime that's being imposed upon us, against every user's will, by the way, there's not a single user who wants DRM. There isn't one. This regime is going to kill culture in the name of fairness. It's going to say tit for tat. Use, value, pay, and culture will die. We will kill it. And we will kill it almost on purpose. It's such a predictable effect, collateral damage in this war, that nobody has an excuse. We know what's going to happen. So this is a tragic irony. If the internet, which is the vehicle, the medium, the world, because it's actually more than a medium. It's a world in which we live and touch one another. If this world that offers hope like we haven't had in centuries, hope for access to information, hope for access to ideas, connection to other people across all these boundaries that have been killing us, if we take this opportunity and turn it into a tit-for-tat fairness regime, controlling the content for the sake of a few pennies going to an author, and even most of those pennies not even going to the author, but going to the middle people, that will be a tragedy. So here we are at this crossroads. In a couple hundred years, our children are going to look back, and they're going to say, huh, this culture was at an interesting point at the turn of the millennium. They could have opened up the world to the world. They could have done that. It could have been the greatest renaissance since the Renaissance, the greatest technology since the printing press, and in some ways far greater, because the printing press didn't connect everybody to everybody else, but this one does. So we could have had the greatest renaissance in history, or we could impose upon ourselves, knowingly, a new Dark Ages. And frankly, I'm scared shitless. Thank you.
Let's take some questions. Questions? Comments? Reactions? Well, I guess you said it all. Thank you very much, Dave.
Ask a question of a grieving idiot.
That's right.
It sort of discourages the...
People are scared to ask questions.
Very nice.
Here's your CD.
Be a couple of minutes.
Do you want to run on my PC?
Well, I have some things on here. It's only this that's on here.
That's fine. So it's coming in. He's got one.
Okay, I'm going to go. Do you have any sound that's going to play in your presentation?
Day two is all about Macs.
No sound.